This time I will not give a talk which is basically presenting new theoretical results, for example, but I will to step back a bit and have a general look at the role of our discipline, computer science and computer technology, what we actually can and must do for our society. But again, since this is in a research environment, I will also give some hints of some kind of new research problem that can arise when you have the chance to put your hands on some billions of source code files. Okay? And so let me start with a little bit of motivation. So if you look around you today, it's easy to see that actually software, it is at the heart of our society. So basically, we use it to communicate, to exchange. It's a fuel for our innovation. It's an engine for industry. It's an indispensable mediator for accessing all information. This is something that we kind of forget, but it is a very special time in human history because it is the first time that our information, our writing, our paintings, our music, is stored in a form which is digital, which is not directly accessible to a human. Okay, so if you think about this, I'm an Italian, I'm still able, it can be surprising, but it actually happens like this, I'm still able to take a 14th century edition of the Divina Commedia from Dante, who is the founder of the Italian language, and I can still read it. The language is mostly the same. The fonts are not exactly the one we use now, but there is no obstacle to understanding what is written there. Imagine now you have some important document stored on an 8-inch floppy disk from the 80s. So not centuries, just some decades ago. What could you do about that? You need to find a place where to put the floppy to read it. Then you understand what are the sequence of bit meaning. Maybe it is a WordStar document. I'm sure around 90% of the people here never heard about WordStar, which was probably the most popular editor when I was a student. So this is a serious problem. It's the first time that all of our information is stored behind a technological means that changes all the time. So software is a mediator for accessing all digital information. This is new. The other thing that is kind of new is that if you look at modern scientific research, there is not a single field of scientific research going from, of course, you know, astrophysics to computer science to mathematics to sociology to linguistics, where you can do work today without using software. And there is a very interesting article which was published in Nature in October 2014. It was an analysis of the 100 topmost article in the history of the journal Nature that I'm sure you know, even if it is not the place where we as computer scientists go to publish something in general, with some exception on robotics or something. In these 100 top papers, the vast majority actually describe experimental methods and software which is used for that particular application. So again, software today is an essential component of everything we do in research. So maybe it is not so bold to say that software today embodies our collective knowledge and cultural heritage. But you see, this is something that I could say to anybody. Okay, and then things say, wow, that's very interesting. I mean, software is so important. But where is actually the knowledge in the software? Is it in the binary of the software which is running on your machine? Or is it in the source code of the software that has been written by people who know what they want this binary to perform as operations? Well, we believe that actually the real knowledge is in the source code. But what is a source code of a piece of software? And for us, I mean, we know this all very well, or we think we know. Okay. There is a very good definition that you can find in the general public license and GPL license, where it is said that the source code for a program is actually the preferred form of this program for a developer to make changes to it. It seems a kind of an abstract description, but you know, if you, I mean, here, for example, there are code generators, which are developed in some of the laboratories here. If you have a code generator, the source code is not what is generated, but it is what you put inside the code generator. So the good answer is not something written in C or in Java or in JavaScript. The good answer is the representation of the program that you would like to have as a developer. Okay, and this is not the horrible pieces of JavaScript that you use in the browser today, for example. When I want to try to explain this to some people who are not technologists, for example, let's try to see it with a simple example. Imagine you have a button, a nice application on your Android or iPhone, whatever, you run it. There is a pop-up coming up with a nice button that says, "Hello World." Beautiful. But then you move to another country and a friend of yours asks you to change the software in such a way that instead of "Hello World," it would say, "Bonjour le monde," "Buongiorno tutti," or "Hola, che tal," something like this. So now there are two choices. You can go and tell the developer, look, here is a binary that you could actually hack to try to find a way of changing the message which is printed. This generally is easy to do if the message you want to replace in place of this is shorter. You just find the place where the string is stored and you change it. If it is longer, it might be more complicated. Okay. But of course, this is one choice. The other, if you ask a developer, the developer will actually prefer to look at what is a source code that is much more readable for him. And here, even for somebody who knows nothing about computers, it is very easy to see where you need to go to change the message that is produced. Okay? So this is a source code. I mean, the fact that the source code is a part which is more important is not really new. I mean, it has been known for a long time. For example, one of the professors that wrote a book which was very influential when I was a student, which is unfortunately a lot of time ago. I mean, unfortunately, because this means I have a little bit more white bird than I would like. This Harold Adelson wrote a beautiful book, Structural Interpretation of Computer Programs, many, many years ago, where he was already saying the programs must be written for humans to read and only accessorily for machine to execute. Okay. But remember, this is a professor telling the students, if you want a good grade, I should be able to understand what you are writing on the paper. Okay? But, and today, I would also like to say, if I'm in a company, I would really like that my developer write software in such a way that the next developer can make changes to it, okay? So for people to read. But when this was written, there was not much source code available to really understand what you would like to see. Things changed enormously over the last 30 years thanks to this free software and open source movement that means that you have access to an incredible amount of source code around. And if you look closely, you can find some jewels there. I don't know if the resolution is good enough for you to, more or less. So for example, I don't remember who actually played once Quake 2. Anybody? Yeah? Remember? So this is the first generation of the games which actually my kids are playing today in the new version, first player shooting. But what is beautiful here that this code was written by an incredible programmer, John Carmack, who had the challenge of making this game work on machines which are not as powerful as today. Not at all as powerful today. So for example, when you do visualization, 3D visualization, you are forced to compute very often 1/√ of something. Okay, this is an operation you must apply a lot of time for doing your visualization. And if you just call the floating point coprocessor on these old machines, it's slow, okay? Very slow, so you cannot play. You are dead before you move the person. So it doesn't work. So what these people, what this guy did was some incredible hack here. So he takes this floating point number, then he converts it to long, I mean, so to an integer, long integer. So you see here the comments say, evil floating point bit level hacking. Okay, so you take the bit level representation of this. Then you do something where the comment, I would not read it, but it's basically, you shift this by 1, so you divide it by 2, and you subtract the result to this magic constant, 5F3759, 6F, where the hell is coming out of. Actually, this hex number is an entry point in Wikipedia. If you put this number in Wikipedia, we'll end up in this precisely in this routine. And then it starts doing some strange operation here, but then you look at the comments, you start understanding. I mean, first iteration, second iteration, this actually can be removed, it has been removed there. Aha. He is doing a Newton approximation of 1 over square root of x, smart trick, and using bits, so multiplication instead of square roots, etc., etc. And this is actually way faster than doing the call to the coprocessor. But now that you have the source code, apart from laughing a bit about the comments here, you understand what is going on. If you only have the binary, there is no way you will ever understand what is really going on. I mean, so the source code is extremely precious. And you have a lot of examples like this. I mean, if you, this is another example extracted from the network U drivers in the Linux kernel, where you have a beautiful data structure represented in such a way to be efficient. So basically, what is the conclusion of this? As Len Shustek, who is the board director of the Computer History Museum, wrote in a beautiful paper from 2006, this is not me. It's not my computer. Later. Okay. As Len Shustek says, I mean, access to the core source code gives you actually a view into the mind of the designer. So why do I insist a lot on this? Because usually, most of our fellow citizens do not see software at all, or if they see it, it is just as a running binary. They don't even think about the real knowledge which is in the source code of this software. Okay, and now the question is, if we are all convinced that source code is so important, are you actually, is it going on? I'll do it this. The pop-up actually changed the focus of the window again. And so the point is that are we actually taking care of this precious heritage of our technological development? The point is that if you start looking around, it is really not the case. First of all, yes, software is everywhere, but the source code of software is everywhere in a bad sense. It is actually spread all around. There are many, many places where you can find software today. There are places where, like SourceForge, which are very popular many years ago, where everybody was going to do the collaborative development, and they basically just disappeared today. GitHub, which is extremely popular today, but who knows in 10 years which will be the good one. And then these are development platforms. There were also two other ones, I mean, Google Code and Gitorius, which were shut down 2 years ago. Then you have also places where you actually distribute code. You don't develop it. I mean, this is a comprehensive R archive network, the comprehensive tech archive network, the comprehensive Perl archive network. Then you have distribution of free software that do actually create packages like Debian or CentOS or Red Hat or whatever. There are so many places. And basically what you don't have today is a universal catalog that gives you the list and the location of everything that is developed out there. So the best approximation we have to do is a search engine. When you look for a piece of code, you just type something in Google and hope to find the right thing. And as you know, when you type something in Google today, and in 2 weeks, you don't get the same answer. Okay, so it changes all the time. So this is actually not a catalog. The other issue is actually, like all digital information, software too is very fragile. And so digital information is fragile, we know it. That's the reason why everybody tells you that you must make a backup of your laptop. Okay? So you can lose your laptop, you can lose your USB keys. And now you have USB keys with 128 gigabytes, so if you lose one USB key, you're losing a lot of stuff. But then there are other things we know, the reason why we do backup. I mean, you can have errors, you remove data by mistake. You can have accidents, I mean, a disk goes on fire, you can have natural disaster, I mean, an earthquake somewhere, etc. All this is pretty well known. That's the reason you have the traditional 3-2-1 law for making backups. I mean, three copies. and on at least two different technologies, at least one off-site. Right? This is the rule of thumb for system administrators. But recently, we have seen new dangers coming up that we were not thinking about. First of all, are malicious attack on our data. So you remember WannaCry and all the other viruses. I mean, incredible amount of viruses that spread around, encrypt all of your data, and then ask you some from $1,000 to $150,000 to get the decryption key. By the way, it seems that it is not interesting to pay because you will not get the decryption key. The only solution is have a backup. This is something which is kind of new. And the other thing which was completely surprising for a lot of people in the community was just business-driven decision to shut down infrastructure we have been using for ages. This is what happened with Digitorius and Google Code. On Google Code, there was 1,500,000 projects being developed there. On Gitorius, 120,000 projects being developed there. They have all been shut down during 2015. Okay. So basically, the point is that if you look around, we do not have an archive. Not only we don't have a catalog, but we don't have an archive. We don't have a place where you go and look for a repository that has disappeared on GitHub or on GitLab or something like this. And third, point of observation, we do not even have a research infrastructure for analyzing the source code, which is the basis for our society today. So you would expect, since you have software everywhere, you have it in your body, in pacemakers, you have it in your everything around you with the Internet of Things, you have in transactions, in the banks, etc. So security, safety, software quality, energy efficiency are essential property for our society today. So you would expect to see, in the same way as our colleagues in physics managed to find billions to fund fantastic tools to look at the stars, you would expect to see a fantastic research infrastructure being developed and put in place to analyze the software, which is a pillar of our society. But unfortunately, I know of many places where you can go and look for the stars, and I know of no place where you can go and look at the map of all the software which is available today. So you see, the state of the nation, if you let me say this, is very unsatisfactory. We don't have a catalog, we don't have an archive, we don't have a research infrastructure. And it is not for lack of money. I mean, if you look around, I mean, you have giant IT giants that make an incredible amount of money, but just don't spend it doing these kind of things. So these were the reasons why we decided 3 years ago to start working on a possible solution for these kind of issues. This is what is called the Software Heritage Initiative. It is an initiative that has precisely as a mission three things: collecting all the source code which is available today, preserving it over time, and sharing, so make it easy for people to access it. And this is done for several reasons, not just for preserving old software, which is surely important. You have jewels, as we have seen, in old software. But it's also an issue of creating the infrastructure that allows to study our current software, the development practices, and improve them. So enhancing the way we develop today software to prepare a better technological future tomorrow. So the idea here is really to build this as a kind of an infrastructure. So you have an infrastructure where you collect, store, preserve, organize, and make accessible all the source code which is around the world. And on top of this, you can actually build a lot of application for cultural heritage, people who want to study the origin of a particular piece of software, for example, for industry, for research, for education. I could spend hours telling you an example of what you could do on this. Let me just focus on one thing, which is research. So in research, for example, we could imagine to use this kind of universal repository of source code as something that completes infrastructure for open access in science, and also something that, again, it is a big research infrastructure for allowing the study of our source code. What I mean by completing the infrastructure for open access in science, if you look at science today, if you really want to preserve knowledge and pass it over to new generation or just to your students, what you need is to actually have the articles, the scientific article we write, and make sure they are accessible to everybody. So this is basically the open access movement that started some almost 20 years ago. So it is well known. Then later on, people started noticing that it is very interesting to have an article saying that if I take this data and apply this transformation, I get 42 as an answer. But if I don't have the data, I don't understand what is going on. So it is necessary to provide also the data sets. So this is a more recent movement. And then later on, people started to understand that you also need the software, because otherwise, you don't know what the transformation actually was. Now, if you look around for articles for open access, you have many solutions. In Cornell, you have an Arxiv, which was an original preprint server. In France, we have our institutional repository, which is called HAL. In the rest of Europe, you have thousands of repositories different in different universities. For data, you have a lot of initiatives too. There is one at CERN, which is called Zenodo. There are many, many, many others. But here, if I may open a parenthesis with a little joke, you know, when I was a student many, many years ago, I was taking a course in databases. I remember my professor insisted a lot on the importance of something which in France is called the référentiel unique, and in English would be the basic idea. I don't remember the technical word, but basic idea: when you build the database, you want to have one and only one logical representation of every concept you have in your data model. Then you want to have many physical copies to avoid losing it, but you want one single logical notion for each thing that you store. And this is actually a beautiful idea, to have just one reference to each concept you have in mind. And this idea is so appealing that when you go out of computer science, a lot of people like it a lot. And so a lot of people want to have their unique reference. And so you end up with a lot of unique references, and so you have no unique references. So unfortunately, the situation with open access today is not really, really good, because if you look for an open access version of a paper, where should I look? Should I go to Arxiv? Should I go to HAL? Should I go to the institutional repository of the University of Heidelberg? Should I go to, where should I go? And of course, all of these repositories are not really interoperable, and you don't actually have a real global catalog despite efforts in this direction. The same for data. So now we are in a situation where for software, up to now, nobody cared. So we are in a magical situation where we can provide one referential object here and hope that there will not be copy around. So the main issue here is to make sure you are satisfying the needs of everybody, so if somebody needs this, will not make another copy. Okay. So making copy, yes. Making copy for replication, yes. But not another version of the data model or another project in the same area. So this is a challenge. We do hope to go there, but we'll see. And so if we really want to go there, what it is really important is to kind of build a network of people, put all the people together working on this project, instead of having the French software heritage project, then you have the German, I don't know in German how you call it, I mean, heritage or something, whatever, and then you have the English or something else. Because in that case, we reproduce this bubble tower that we don't want. So how do you do this? The first thing is that we actually try to focus only on the infrastructure. This is an old lesson from the Unix world. I mean, do one thing, do it well, but just one thing. So the idea here, we just focus on building this repository, and we want to make sure that everybody can use it for all possible applications. But we don't do any of these applications. So you want to use it for cultural heritage, for industry, for science, for whatever, be my guest, tell me what you need. I will not provide you the application. I will give you the interface, the API, which is necessary for building this. So this is for the upside. And then the principles are, first of all, open approach globally. Okay? We are telling people we are going to collect and preserve software on the long term. Of course, if I use tools which are proprietary, you should not believe me. Okay? What is going to be preserved over the long term if I use a tool? It has no description of how it works today. So everything we do is open source, and the way we take decision is transparent today. The other thing is that since we plan to be there for the long term, first solution is no, we are not building a company. It would be easy to raise venture capital with an idea like this, but we have seen people like Google, who has billions in the banks, they all of a sudden decided to close a global repository. So who prevents a company from just changing her mind during the operation? Or take the case of Gitorius, okay? 120,000 projects. They were bought up by GitLab, and the day they were bought up, they sent a message to everybody, including me, the head project on their place, saying, good news, we have been bought, fantastic, we have a lot of money. So, okay, so this is good news for him. And then says, well, now there is no point in keeping two repositories up, so you actually have 3 weeks to take your stuff and go away, okay? And we will just shut everything down. So no, okay? So creating a single company is not an idea. The only solution is to actually create a non-profit, multi-stakeholder organization, which is, of course, much more complicated, painful, difficult to do, but I believe it's the only solution to make this working for the long haul. And then apply replication at all possible level. Replication means try different technology for storing data. Make sure you have mirrors all over the place, not just saying, I have one fantastic data center somewhere in some place on the world, there is no issue. No, make sure everybody, there are many copies around the world, under different administration and under different jurisdiction. Why? Because there are many ways of killing a project. One is technical, the other is law. I don't know if you know, but in this moment in Brussels, they are starting to work on a European copyright reform. There is a special article, Article 13, that says that whatever repository where somebody in the public can put their data freely, must implement an automated filter that will prevent deposit of material which is violating the copyright of somebody else. But you understand, the real reason is they do not want that the new version of Star Trek or Star Wars or whatever goes on a file sharing platform before you pay to see it in the movies and in the cinema. And I should say, I agree, okay? But the law is written in such a blanket way that actually prevents GitHub from working, it prevents your institutional repositories from working, it will prevent us from working properly. Because I should put in place an automated filter that removes from the archive everything which is potentially infringing the right of somebody else. We cannot do that. So the only way of making sure the project will not die in the long term is to make sure that you have copies in different places. So if you have a silly law passing in one country, it is probably not the same that will pass in the country nearby. Okay? So that's the only way of having this kind of protection. And so finally, again, this is not a new idea. It is not my idea. I would like to be the one who has idea of this kind of replication. It is a very old idea. I mean, if you take this guy, Thomas Jefferson, was one of the first presidents of the United States. He actually the guy who invented public libraries. Okay, in there. Yeah? And so in this letter, these are the old time where you wrote letters with actual ink on the paper. And so somebody is sending him some precious document from the US Revolution, which was saved from fire, and ask him what should he do to preserve them. Look at this. It should probably go in all the textbooks on high availability of data today, you know, resilient architectures. He basically say, yes, we need to do everything necessary to save what remains of these documents. I will not read this. I mean, it is too poetic, it's fantastic, so you see it. I mean, not by putting them under lock and key, but by making so many copies that whatever accident will not actually destroy all the copies. That's a basic idea. So, how are we doing about this? Okay, are we really trying to do this properly? So, what we managed to up to now? The situation is this. So we managed to find some 50 plus supporting institutions that share the vision, that say, yes, this is something that is valuable to do and we support your initiative. There you find people that you know. I mean, the Creative Commons, for example, the IEEE software, the ACM Six Software Working Group, the Free Software Foundation, GitHub, even GitHub, I mean, free software, everything. And there are 40 more of people saying this is important, and somebody who took the time to actually write a support letter. That's very nice, because you get awareness, but it doesn't pay the bill for your machines, and doesn't pay the bills for the salary for the engineers. So now we needed people to help in this direction. So the first big thanks goes to INRIA, which actually is the institution who decided to support this work in the first place. And they actually were there from the day one, I mean, supporting the first team and letting it grow. And then slowly we are trying to get more diverse sponsors. Today we have Microsoft, Intel, Société Générale, Huawei, Nokia, also GitHub. It is not still yet, we didn't sign it up. It is not fully signed, but I can tell you they are on board, a sponsor today. DANCE, which is an archival network in the Netherlands, and the University of Bologna. And as you see, I have left a lot of white space here, because actually there is space for a lot of people to come in. I mean, we are not, doors are open.
It's Huawei France or Huawei China?
It's Huawei China. You know how complicated this is. Okay. It's not finished. I mean, they had the first step in, and I hope to motivate them a little bit more. And so that was the first. So getting word of mouth around, getting some initial resources, and then you need to get political awareness, which is still another level. So there, last April, we actually managed to have an agreement signed between INRIA and UNESCO on preservation and access to software as part of our fundamental human knowledge, which is new, pretty new. So you see the picture here, Antoine Petit, the CEO of INRIA, Irina Bokova, who is the current Director General of UNESCO, I mean, with a new election coming in the next weeks, and our former President of the Republic here in France, which are present with 400 people in a huge place. And you can look at the speeches of these people. You will see speeches of high-level political dignitaries that say that programming is important, the coding is important, the software is important, and we should take care about all of this, which is kind of new. Okay? Doesn't happen that often. It's really important. And two weeks ago, there was another meeting we organized together with UNESCO where you had a call on preserving our software heritage, little age, not the project, the concept. So all this is going on rather well. But now, enough about politics and vision. I think you are curious to know a little bit more about the technology which is underlying this. Okay? How do we do this? Well, today, our archive, if you look at it, contains over 65 million different projects, which amount to almost 4 billion individual source code files. And when I say unique source code files, is that if the same source code file is used in many places, we store it only once in the archive, and you just keep link to it. So, see, this is fully deduplicated, and almost 1 billion commits, and again, commits are fully deduplicated in the archive. The current sources are these ones, so GitHub is fully in sync. That is to say, we have a full copy of everything that goes on GitHub, not one shot, but synchronized. Okay? Synchronized, not immediately, because it's too expensive to be synchronized immediately, but in a rather short term. We have a full copy of the development, what goes on in the Debian distribution, which is much smaller, but really important because really curated by a set of developers. All the history of the GNU project, Debian is actually being automated today. I see. We are almost finishing the automation of the import of everything which is Go there. And then the good news is actually we managed to get in touch with the people at GitOris and the people at Google Code before the repository were shut down. So we have a full copy of everything which was on GitOris, everything which was in Google Code, and it has been almost completely ingested in the in our archive. The next in line is Bitbucket, but you will see we cannot pretend with a small team to do all this work. It is really important to have our people jumping in, and we tried to make it easy for other people to collaborate on this. I will try to show you a little bit more. So what is a data size? Basically, it is between 150 to 100 terabytes of raw data, I mean the file contents, compressed. There's a database that contains the structure of this data in more or less 5 terabytes. And what we have is a graph which has 7 billion nodes and more or less 60 billion edges today. We will see now why I'm talking about a graph. And this is actually today already the richest source code archive in the world. Okay, there is nothing bigger out there. And growing, of course, because our goal is to actually go after every single piece of software ever written. Now, why I'm talking about a graph here? Because actually, when we go and try to archive things, we are not just archiving files. We are archiving more than that. So what we plan to archive is, of course, all the content of each source code file which is available out there, but also all the revisions, the commit, the releases, the origins. That is, I have found this particular project in that particular forge or repository on this particular date. We have all traceability information here. And you want to store this in a canonical data model which doesn't depend on the version control system that you use. Up to now, we don't archive wikis, home pages, mailing lists, issues, etc. Not because it is not important, but because there are other people trying to do this already. Okay, there is another project which is called GHTorrent that keeps track of all the issues and events on GitHub, for example. And we like to work with them instead of reinventing another copy of what they have already done. And how does this look like? How does this operation look like? And why we need the help of people? Imagine you want to build this. You want to build a machine that gets all the source code out there and keep a copy of it. I imagine many of you use something which is called the Internet Archive. Okay? Remember, this is a machine that archives all the web and allows you to look at the page of your perfect enemy and find what the mistake he made 2 years ago and showing him, look what was on your web page 2 years ago. Exactly. It's very, very nice. But you know, building an archive of the web is a huge undertaking, but technically it is not very difficult because all the web server all speak HTTP. And what you get through HTTP are some contents where you are just looking for URLs, which are very well normalized. So building a web crawler, in principle, technologically, is not rocket science. Making it efficient is very complex. But if you want to do the same for source code, situation is a little bit more complicated because now I need to go and talk to GitHub, to GitLab, to Debian, to NPM, to CPAN, to Bitbucket, whatever, and there is no standard. There is no HTTP there. Yes, I talk to them with the REST API in HTTP, but they all speak different languages. So the event feed for GitHub has nothing to do with the event feed for GitLab, that doesn't exist, by the way, which has nothing to do with the event feed for Bitbucket. So we are in a Babel Tower situation where we need to build adapter for every one of these sources just to list the contents. Then when you list the contents, what you get is somebody using Git, somebody using Mercurial, somebody is using Subversion. Then you have all stuff using CVS. Then you have SCCS. Then you have Bazaar. Then you have Darks. I mean, you have tons of different version control systems, all different, the one from the other, not the same data model. So now we need to understand what is going on and translate this in a single unique representation in our uniform data model. So this is a second step of building adapters, one for each of these technologies out there. And why we do this? Because actually what we are building is much more than just an archive. our data representation is actually a gigantic Merkel directed acyclic graph, which is not a new idea. So if you look at the date here, I mean, Merkel trees were invented at the end of the 80s just to, for having an efficient way of creating signatures for big amounts of data. It's a beautiful data structure which combines two key notions in computer science, one which are trees and the other which are hash functions. And it works in the way that I believe you understand very well. So you have a block of data here, you compute a hash of it, you have a hash there. And not in the block of data, you compute a hash, you got here. Then you take these two hashes, you put them together, and this is another file. So you compute a hash on it, you get the hash here. And you go up and up and up. At the end, the hash that you get here exactly identifies all the structure you are storing. So it was an old idea that has become extremely popular today. So today it is used in Git, which is the version control system we use, in the blockchains, I mean, bitcoins, blockchains, all this stuff, distributed file system like IPFS, version configuration system like Nix or NixOS, etc. It is very popular today. And what it, for us, what is really important is that this allows to have built-in deduplication. Okay? So if you have two files which are the same, they have the same hash, and I don't store it twice. I just keep the hash at the representation. So here I had a long description of how this works, but I will probably skip it. You just trust me, I will give you the slides later on. And also, today, if you want to play with the content of the archive, you can. Okay, there is an API which is open today. You can go and visit it a little bit to see what is inside. You cannot download the content yet, but you can play with the graph. And what are the challenges that arise from such a thing, from such a structure? First of all, there are challenges in how we actually build the archive. Okay. For example, you see in this representation with the Merkel trees, we are doing deduplication at the file level. Every file is a block. I compute an hash in there, and I have two files which are the same, have the same content, I have the same hash, I don't duplicate them. But, so it is very efficient to copy file clones, you resist to technology change in representation, but the problem is that if you edit a file and you change one little character, you create another file, while most of the content is the same. So it's kind of silly of duplicating the full file, okay? But we stop there, we stop at the level of a file. So a big question is, can we actually find a way of compressing these files, exploiting the file the similarity of the content inside the file? Okay. And here, probably most of you will tell me, but come on, I mean, all the data you are getting are coming from a version control system, so it is already done like this. You already have the diffs, okay, one after the other. Yes, but the point is that we are deduplicating across tons of different file systems. The same file can come from very different histories of development. So what should I do? I take the compression of one and not the other. What is the best one? And I would like to find a way of making this kind of compression of the data independently of the version control system from which it comes. So if you look in the literature, I have seen there is a little bit of work done here in the field of forensic analysis. So there are people who actually look for snippets of code which are copied here and there. And they have some interesting stuff where you can see in some example compression rates that can go from two orders of magnitude. So think of what it means. You would say instead of 200 terabytes, I would have 2 terabytes. It almost fits on a USB key. So you almost have the dream of the Hitchhiker's Guide of the Galaxy. You have all the history of human computing on one USB key. That would be fantastic. But first, we need some active researcher that goes through all this data and finds a way of compressing the data at the file level. For the director, we already did it properly. Okay? But for the file level, we don't know. The other thing is metadata. Okay? If you look at what we do, we actually store software coming from different origins. But everything we represent has traceability information that stops at the root of the version control system. And there is where things start becoming hairy, because now what is a metadata for a software project? Complicated issue. What is a project? What is software? What does it mean? How you describe it? What are the keys? What is the vocabulary that you can use? Ah, yes, probably there is a developer, developers, because more than one, programming language, programming languages, because maybe there are many programming languages in the same project. Then there is a web page, pages, maybe many pages. What is the vocabulary for describing what a project is? And if you look outside, there are many, many ideas around. So there is an ontology which is called description of a project. There is another which is friend of a friend, which can be used for developers. There is a metadata using in Debian 2A, which is upstream. There is schema.org, which has other ideas. ADMS.sw. Actually, if you look, there are more than 40 different ontologies around, not exactly aligned. And there are many, many catalogs outside which are interesting. For example, Free Code, which was the old Fresh Meat, which was dead in 2013. There are 40,000 records describing pieces of software which are written by humans. So this is interesting information. I mean, so people spend time to describe what was there. Then you have in Debian 25,000 description of the source packages, again, written by humans. Then you have OpenHub, where they try semi-automatically to get information with some crowdsourcing on some 100,000 projects. We have 65 million projects there. What kind of ontology should we develop? How can we build automatically the information for that? How do we reconcile existing ontologies? Like the same project, I have information here and there and there and there with different vocabularies. How do we reconcile them automatically? Because by hand, it will take a lot of time. So this is still another challenge. And other thing that could be fun to do is if you have all the history of development of all the project is, you know, code migrates across projects. Projects migrate across forges. Okay, there are code that get cloned, projects that get cloned in different mirrors and packages. So one could try to play some game of phylogenetics in there. So building the history of how a software project evolved over time. Okay, find the history of a software artifact across all this graph. Look. Find the first one where something actually arrived. Build some metrics for impact graphs on the software. And this particular source code had a lot of impact in other development because they reuse this and that. So these are other challenges. We don't know how to do it properly. In particular, not at this scale. Okay, you can do it on toy example, but when you have 60 million projects and billions of files, a quadratic algorithm, for example, no, okay, you need something more efficient than that. And then also even just the architecture, what we're doing, our infrastructure, how would you build a distributed infrastructure properly? So in our graph, you have files, directories, commits, revision, metadata, all this, and we need an efficient way of replicating this information across mirrors and then providing efficient navigation in this information. So what is a good query language? What is an efficient way of querying this kind of data structure? And then, you know, you have this old theorem in database, the CAP theorem that says consistencies, availability, partition resistance, pick two. That is to say, you cannot have the three of them. You can only have two. Now, there is a lot of debate about this kind of theorem here. But in this particular case, we are only adding data. We are never removing data. So what we are doing is kind of special. So maybe we can have an eventual consistency that works properly under which condition or something like this. And again, I don't claim to have any answer. These are all questions for you, okay? Not for me. And this is just for building the archive. Then you have challenges for using the archive. One thing, I mean, the most natural thing is search. Now we have all the code of the planet. How can I search efficiently across billions of lines of code? So ideally, you would like to say, I'm starting to write an HTTP server. And in the middle, automatically I have a recommender that comes up and says, what you are doing looks like what has been done in that particular project. I do suggest to complete your program automatically like this one. Beautiful dream for a student, a big nightmare for the teachers, you know? I mean, but this is, then we need to build another tool to to see, no, you copied this there, okay? But the point is, okay, it's fantastic, but how do you do it at this scale? So this is something we have known for a while, and for example, every programmer is very used to have regular expression, okay? That's a Swiss knife of developers. You look for code with some regular expression here and there, and it's very old, so you would say, what's the point? Roberto, what are you telling us? I mean, of course we know the solution, regular expression. Yeah, okay, regular expression. But regular expression are fun over a small file. I have 4 billion files. So what do we do? Well, actually, this is not really new. Some people at Google started working on this in 2006 on something which was called the Google Code Search. It disappeared, no? But before it was closed, it is one of the many things that Google does, and then they go away. But luckily here, before it was closed, they released the code as open source. So people in Debian actually reused this code and built something which is used. You can do regular expression search on the source code of the Debian code base. That's only 20,000 projects. Okay? And basically, it works in a very funny way. So you build an inverted index on 3 grams extracted from all the source files. So you take all the full files, you take all the 3 grams, build an inverted index that tells you basically for each 3 gram in which source code files it appears. Then there is a smart algorithm for mapping your regular expressions to a set of these 3 grams. So you say, if you write a regular expression, which is, if your regular expression is point star, you can do nothing, okay, because this maps everywhere. But if you have something a little bit more complicated, you can compile it into a set of possible 3 grams that can be matched by the regular expression. You use it as a filter. You say, I will just run grep only on the files that actually match this set of 3 grams. So you reduce the amount of work, and then you grep on each file using the cloud, I mean, thousands of machines running for you. This works fine up to 1 billion lines of code. Lines of code, not files, 1 billion lines of code. Here we are talking about 4 billion files. So 400 billion lines of code. Little bit bigger. So, what's the solution? Apart from throwing a lot of money into a gigantic cloud, 400 bigger cloud, that's a possibility. Okay. So scaling up is not easy. And then this is just the beginning. You would like to do a search for patterns in coding or working on the abstract syntax trees, not just on the text representation. And again, the question is again the scale. What do you suggest to do this at this scale? And not just on a little prototype. And finally, remember, I mean, we have a gigantic amount of data here on which you can imagine to do an incredible amount of analysis on software engineering, I mean, looking for programming patterns, vulnerabilities, bugs and fixes, etc. But you need to find the best representation for this data to be used in big data or machine learning. Up to now. So the representation we have, which is a Merkle tree, is ideal for storage because it is compact, but is not at all the good one for doing massive analysis of the data. What would be the good representation for massive analysis of the data? Is it the same for any kind of analysis you do, or is it different depending on the kind of use you want to do? So these are just questions that come up. Okay? And if you talk to engineers working at Google, Facebook, etc., they will always tell you the only solution to be efficient on this kind of scale is to make all the data fit in memory. Okay. If you go to a disk, you're dead. So you need to have everything in memory. So you must find a very, very, very efficient way of putting all this stuff in central memory today. Okay. So what is the best representation for this kind of graph that could fit in memory and that can be used to do non-local queries or these kind of things? These are all challenges. And again, the challenges are new because of the scale, not by the challenge itself. Well, it was long already, so I think there are enough questions here for people who are interested. If you want to discuss it more, I will be available. Let me just conclude now. So this is a project which I believe is very, really fascinating. We are trying to build a reference archive for all source code I've ever written. I am writing here free and open source software, but actually it's broader than that. It's a big tool for research on software. It potentially will be a big tool with enough money, enough resources, enough collaboration. It's a complement for development platforms. It is not GitHub, okay? So you're developing, you keep doing it on GitHub or whatever else. It is just the archive, the catalog of research infrastructure. It is not a place where you can make pull requests. And it is organized in such a way to build a kind of an open, non-profit, mutualized infrastructure. We have taken the time to write down the basic principle of what we do and explain it in a high level in a paper which was published, presented just a couple of weeks ago in iPress, which is a conference for digital preservation, because this is the kind of people we need to talk to now about these kind of things. You can get it here. So this is a short URL. If you want to contribute, our code is all available here. You can find all the source code here. There is an IRC chat room, which is swh-devel, if you want to chat with the people developing in here. There are some information on the ideas we have, internships sometimes on this wiki here. Then you have the flashy advertising website, which is this one. Where you can point to your rich friends if they don't know what to do with their millions. We have many ways of getting these millions in every possible currency. Okay. So again, I think this is enough to give you a presentation of the project. I'm open to any kind of question you might have about all this. And thank you for your attention.